I am in Gainesville, Florida. I flew all the way from California, hopped in a car with my friend, and drove 700 miles down here to meet one of my heroes, Jerry Uelsmann, the master of multi-image photography with the surrealistic touch.
Hey, welcome. Welcome to Florida.
Well, pleasure to meet you.
All right, come on in.
Thank you for your hospitality.
All right.
Hi, Jerry. Thanks so much for letting us into your home and welcoming us so nicely and discussing photography with you, with us. And I'd like to congratulate you on your new book, Untitled, and also for winning the Lucy Award for Fine Art Photography.
Thank you.
Could you describe for us what was the magic moment when you shifted from printing just one negative to printing multi-images?
Well, there's no really magic moment. There's a point at which when you're young, you really begin exploring options of all kinds of photography. And I had, you know, the benefit of some outstanding teachers. And at one point, at the same time that I was doing documentary work, I was also exploring creative options of the camera initially, multiple exposures, and then eventually doing stuff in the darkroom. But there's just, you know, a time period where you're trying to find a path that you feel more comfortable with. But in those days, it was just a matter of figuring out where I felt most comfortable. And I still am very happy with my documentary work, but there was a point at which I was majoring in photography as a graduate student and minoring in art history that I began exploring a little more seriously what the options were within the darkroom. And there is a long tradition, but most people aren't aware of it. There was a major show at the Metropolitan Museum just a couple of years ago called Faking It, which shows that manipulation occurred from the very beginning of photography.
Well, we don't think that you're faking it. We think you're the real deal.
There we go.
And so, what types of cameras, film, and darkroom equipment do you prefer?
Well, the equipment issues, to me, it's really not so important. I mean, the camera is essentially a license to explore. So I basically wanted the largest format camera I could get and still use roll film, because I wanted to be able to shoot with the convenience of roll film as opposed to sheet film and film holders. And I initially had a Bronica, the poor man's Hasselblad, which I still have a Bronica. And in recent years, I've been using the Mamiya 6.7 format because it's a little bit lighter. It's a rangefinder kind of camera, has excellent lenses. But again, you don't have to have a particular kind of camera. My joke was always that I wanted a 35mm camera that when you developed a film, it expanded to 4x5 inches. But I shoot 120 size film, and I've been basically dealing with the T-Max 400 and the T-Max 100, which are exceptionally fine-grained film. And, you know, darkroom equipment, again, you go to the major photo shows in New York now, no one has enlargers anymore, but I have these old Saunders enlargers that, they're not that old, but they have a lot of features, a variable contrast head that gives me incredible options in terms of contrast dodging. And I was raised in the purist tradition, so I really want to celebrate the same tonal range that Ansel had in his prints. And I struggle to, you know, maintain that shadow and highlight detail.
That must be quite a challenge when you're using 6 or 7 negatives.
Well, you get, you know, it's like, I work in the darkroom on a regular basis, and so there's a point at which you begin. I mean, I can look at a negative and instantly tell what filter I'm going to use when I print it initially, and then I may make a second decision after I see the print come up that another area could be dodged or burned in with a lower contrast grade. You just have tons of options within the process. Very subtle. And very few people would recognize, you know, the differences. But from my point of view, there's a level of connoisseurship that I want to maintain. So if I can improve the image in any way, 2% or whatever, I'm willing to make that extra effort to do it. So you can see there's, well, this is actually, this was last year too. And that was really hard to do. The question is itself, because I made 10, 15 bits of it without the negative figure. And then I decided I should do it. And it was so hard to introduce that subtly in there. And then to get this silhouette thing of that addressing it, my God. This had 7 enlarges going on. So yeah. And that's just, I'm tearing paper to, just in the enlarger. Create that.
Oh, okay.
Well, here's one of the symmetrical, this would have been done. And this was, I only had the one negative. So these colors are the same, but you have to trust yourself that you can print half of it and figure it out.
That's a beautiful one. I really love that.
But then figuring the horizon line. Here's
Central Park.
Yeah, there's the Central Park one with
that. Yeah, I have a bunch of these I can show you from last year. That was, again, a hard one to do. I mean, I look at them now technically. I'm going to be printing them again.
Now, where is this?
That's, there are only 2 or 3 existing Baroque theaters. This was in a place called Český Krumlov in the Czech Republic. Because most of them burned down there because they had candlelight. And I had done things in Czech Republic before, and a woman there who was our translator initially knew these people. And we got to go to this museum when it had just closed, because normally you're not allowed to photograph. But it was a great setting.
You've used the bird in quite a few photos.
Yeah, I think I just want to add a darker element, a questioning element.
What were some of your major influences when you were young in terms of photography?
Well, I initially had it as a hobby, and then I found that when I was in high school, actually doing photography was a way of interacting with people, which, helped bring me out in certain ways. And then, once I began studying photography, I really intersected with key teachers, who basically expanded my perceptions about what photography could be, because there was limited access to what we would consider art photography today. Very little was published. There was the photo annual that, featured certain things. But, Ralph Hattersley when I was at RIT, Minor White certainly, Beaumont Newhall. I had really amazing teachers, and I always like to say they answered my questions with more interesting questions. And it greatly expanded my perception of what could be done, with the camera and within the darkroom too. So, and there are many others. My main teacher, Henry Holmes Smith at Indiana University, had taught with Mahoney Nash when he was in Chicago for a year. And he was very open to experimentation of all kinds, so he was very receptive and encouraging of the things that I was trying to do. And you just need that kind of support, to affirm that what you're doing has some kind of, aesthetic value. When you're young, you have many paths. So I was introduced to all kinds of photography, and there's early work that was very documentary. It was a slum or poor district near Indiana University called Pigeon Hill, and I did a documentary project where I photographed there for months on that part of town. But at the same time, I was also exploring options within the darkroom, and I was trained to do kind of formal portraits, which I gave that up relatively soon. But again, you're sort of exploring options. And partly things would happen that caused me to be open to the darkroom, in the beginning, being raised in the purist tradition, the whole idea, and this is the dominant aesthetic in photography today, is that the images are camera conceived. That's the main creative gesture you make, is when you click the shutter. And I would get out with my camera and be trying to photograph and walking around. And if I thought too much, I could talk myself out of anything. You know, God herself could appear. And I'm like, what does this mean? And so I really found that I had fragments of things that I had responded to that then maybe I could do something with later in the photographic process within the darkroom, that you could extend, you know, that creative moment into the process. Because as it is for most people today, you create the image at the camera, and then the darkroom was the, you know, the prescribed ritual that caused it to be, you know. And I really opened up at least the idea that the darkroom could essentially be a visual research lab, and there are tons of options that were available there that were not considered, I guess, appropriate by the masses, but they did open, you know, paths of exploration for me. And then the other factor, truly, once I was a graduate student, I was around people that were painting majors, sculpture majors, ceramic majors, art history majors, and they were very open to anything that I was doing, as opposed to most photographers. As I said, I've gotten the response that, well, this is interesting, but this is not what photography should do. But I think that, you know, the limits exist within you. It's not the medium that controls the content, but photography does have an inherent believability quality, and that has, in a sense, helped my images in that people see it and it's photographic, yet it's presenting a reality that is beyond their literal perception. And so there's a sort of psychological dissonance that occurs there that I think causes people to engage with these images. And, you know, I'm a big fan of Magritte, but people realize those are paintings, and so there's a way in which they're slowly created. But that inherent believability, because from the time we're very young, people show us, you know, this is where you used to live, you know, this is your grandmother here, or whatever. You get conditioned to believe in photographs. And even in this day of Photoshop, people still find that that's a reality that they can address, that the photography documents the real world somehow. And I think, just one final thing on this thought, basic thing, this is a simplistic thing, but I think it's very true, the world exists in us as much as it does around us. You know, your attitude toward nature determines the nature that you photograph, that you interact with. So this is the bottom line that I believe in terms of my own art.
Can you discuss your mixing of the indoor environment with nature in your art, and if this has any special significance to you?
Well, the one image that I made where there's a man in the study and there's a cloud ceiling is one that got, you know, has a lot of support. And one gallery dealer started calling it the Philosopher's Study. It was basically untitled, but I like that title. I don't know. I just think, again, the idea that you can introduce other reality possibilities with an image is exciting. And, you know, some images work more successfully. But when I'm building an image or creating one, I don't really think rationally about that sort of thing. I photograph clouds a lot when I'm at the beach or even on the West Coast, not knowing where I would introduce those. And recently I've struggled to introduce clouds into a totally different environment where within a room a cloud would exist. And a lot of it just has to do with, you have the technical challenge of how can you do it, and then the sort of the psychological challenge of what are the implications of all this. But I do it at a more intuitive kind of level. There's no rational, like, it's going to mean this if I do that. But people tend to respond to those images that have, you know, interior, exterior events, you know, happening with them. The image that we made in the darkroom yesterday when you were here, you know, you transpose from a figure basically sitting at a table to a landscape that's, showing in the background. So I'm still doing that.
Many of your images contain reverse negatives. How do you achieve this? And is this an aesthetic choice or a symbolic choice?
If I had to define photography, photography is simply light remembering itself. I mean, that's pure and simple, covers all the bases. and you have all kinds of options. And the negative is a photographic phenomena. There are people in the past, Wynne Bullock and Frederick Sommer, that have made prints where the print is negative. And it's just another aesthetic option. And if you have a figure in an image, both positive and the negative tends to be more representative of sort of a psychological self, that, you know, there's the facade that we have, but then that inner reality. And I'm basically printing through a print, which I didn't try for years, because when I studied photography, if they showed work that involved the paper negative, it was 19th century and it was very impressionistic. But if you have resin coated paper and you have a dry print, and if you have a vacuum easel, tight contact, you can indeed reverse an image so that it's negative. But all of these things are just, it's a matter of, at one point, you're sort of building a vocabulary as you're using it. So to understand the techniques is one thing, but to find a way in which they work with an image is the other. And the analogy I would make, you know, you could memorize the dictionary, but you're not going to say profound things, hello. So, but you have to have these tools, whether you're working digitally or analog as I do, that prevent visual options for you, and then you have to begin to have some personal rapport with why you would want to employ those options. And the bottom line for me is, if when someone looks at my work, and photographers tend to do this, they're more guilty of this than normal people, if their first response is like, how did he do it? I feel I've failed. And so in terms of the creative process, there must be a lot of tolerance for self-doubt and uncertainty, because that's part of it. Because as long as you're comfortable with whatever you're doing, you've done that before. And so many people, you know, it's the cliche image. That's the first thing you think of. You know, you see the sunset and, boy, I got it. And, you know, where do you go from there? You know, I've gone to Yosemite 20 times at least, and the first few times, everywhere I looked, I saw Ansel's photographs, you know, and it's so picturesque, you know, these mounts are calling down, take my picture, you know, that sort of thing. And I really had to go through a phase where I took those pictures knowing that I wasn't going to pretend to be Ansel, you know. I mean, I have to realize that, you know, Ansel had licked that biscuit before me, as we would say in the South here. But at the same time, by going through that process, it freed me up to be able to photograph in Yosemite and find subject matter that I could employ to create my own personal view, you know, of what my experience is. I've said this many times, the world exists in us as much as it does around us. And, you know, you can think of very simple analogies, you know, if someone who's a lumber person sees a forest, they can think in terms of how many houses you can build. If an ecologist sees it, you know, or if someone who just, they have different attitudes based on, you know, their response is affected by their attitudes toward that subject matter.
What is your process when determining how to combine your various negatives?
There's no logical process for, you know, where to start. I mean, people who are writers, once you write the first sentence, then you've got to go from there. And sometimes it goes somewhere and sometimes it goes nowhere, you know, but you start there. And so I basically, when I photograph, I try to be authentic as I can be. I respond to things, and I realize some photographs end when you click the shutter. It's like saying, I love you, rock, and you photograph that rock. But then if you've worked long enough, you know, you may photograph that rock and then you're suddenly like, well, how's it look if I shoot down on it? How does it look if I get on the ground and go up at it? You know, you try to have some kind of interaction with this subject matter that initially, you know, attracted you. And the camera gives you permission to do that. You know, you can see interesting cracks in the sidewalk. And if you didn't have a camera around your neck and you stood there looking at it, people would like, excuse me, what's going on with this person? But if you have the camera, it gives you a justification for exploring what might be the visual options of these cracks. But at that point, I have no problem shooting film. I recently was in Sweden. I shot 14 rolls of film in, I don't know, 5 days or something, you know. But then later, when I come back with that material and I make my contact sheets, it's a new beginning. I'm not locked into the camera perceived image. For most photographers, the primary creative gesture is when they click the shutter. And then they want to, you know, manifest that image in some way through a darkroom process, analog, or through an Epson printer or Photoshop or whatever. And in my case, you know, I'm trying to respond authentically to the world, and sometimes they look, you know, reasonably good as straight prints, but I like the options that the darkroom, which can essentially be considered a visual research lab if you don't follow the prescribed ritual. But the way it's been taught for many, many years is, you know, this is the traditional ritual that you do. And at the same point, all of these things have infinite possibilities on how you, you know, think about the way in which you're going to build this image. So I spend a lot of time looking at contact sheets, thinking things that might go together, that are worth trying. And once I have at least, you know, two things clipped together, then it's a matter of just have the proper attitude, say, go do this, Jerry. And some days there is self-doubt, but once I make that print, then that gives me other ideas. Because there's an ongoing dialogue. You're addressing this image as it's emerging in the developer constantly. And so your mind is running through all these technical concerns, at the same time aesthetic concerns, and it gets into a kind of zone that I find is somewhat meditative, where you have self-doubts, but you're building the mountain that you're climbing, essentially. And in the better moments, it's you suddenly look at the clock and 3 hours have passed, and you really don't have a lightning strike or where you think, oh, that's a great image. That's the last thing on your mind. You're trying to just resolve it at the moment that you're working on it. And many times for me, because I work alone in my darkroom, I will the next day look at these prints that I thought were so wonderful and think, hey, there's something else I can do with this. Or there's another thing that I want to change on it. That by having it a night past, because you have a lot of cognitive dissonance in that if you've spent days on something, you think it has to be better than if it just came to you in a quick way. And I mean, one time a very famous poet, I was at a little seminar with him, I was here at the university, and he was reading his poems, and he read one, he said, I was at a traffic light and I got this idea, I could hardly wait to get to my office, and then he read this poem. Then he read another poem, and he said, now this, I've been working on this one for 23 years. And maybe he read parts and he thought, just the words didn't flow right. How do you know if you've gone too far unless you go too far? I mean, there are times when I feel I've overdone it. It's like, so you're juggling 10 balls. What's the point of all that? There has to be some basic humanistic content level that one can relate to. And my images, again, they come from just trying to be authentic. I'm not, I have great respect for all kinds of photography. I mean, people who document the tragedies that are going on in the world today, that's an incredible commitment, that they have to do that and to do it well. But mine is much more of the, artist in the studio creating images that, personally relate to their life and their feelings and attitude toward life. And basically, in the world of art, the broad umbrella of art, when you go from the 19th into the 20th century, you basically go from what was initially outer-directed art to inner-directed art. Initially, art served the needs of the patron, of the religious belief systems, of whatever the political stance was, the social implications of your art. To art that was much more personal. And just in terms of painting, you can think of, suddenly when people like Van Gogh occur, there's a much more individual style, and the belief that the artist could invent a personal reality that was more meaningful than the one that was literally given to the eye. And I feel I'm very much a part of, that whole tradition, that for me, I have images that relate to all kinds of things that have happened in my life, and that I'm amazed the extent to which it can travel, that I've been in other countries where people don't have the same language, and they find ways of connecting to these images. I do think there is a psychological base to a lot of my images that draw people in, that they're, you know, obviously symbolic, but not symbolically obvious. And, you know, I've always felt, and I've said this many, many times, that the viewer completes the image. And I'm always impressed when people find personal ways of, you know, relating to the images that I create. I just had experiences with last month in Norway when there was an exhibit, and my work was the first that you saw when you came into this little gallery space. And the woman that was a volunteer who had to sit at this table, you know, periodically she would turn around and look at one of my images, and it's the one, the Voyager with the symmetrical clouds in the boat. Well, one day, this assistant, this woman, Moa, had helped me from Sweden, said, you should talk to her. Well, she found all kinds of images in there, ways in which she related to this, and then she had some story about her father thinking about a boat when he was dying, and it went on, and it was just wonderful to me to hear someone from another culture totally find a basis in which they could connect with the image. And I've had that happen more than once. Sometimes it's very hard for people to articulate it. When you create the images, you have to get into some other zone. I mean, I always make the analogy with music because I'm a big blues fan, but I've been to, like, you know, Buddy Guy concerts where at a certain point he's like one with the instrument. It's just, it goes into this other zone. And that same potential can exist within, you know, the act of photographing, you know, those special moments. And for me, in the case of the darkroom, and even the concept of the quote, the decisive moment that, you know, Carter-Bisson mentioned, decisive moment can occur in the multiple printing process at any point where you suddenly think, oh, this begins to work. And it's not necessarily intellectual, it's just the gut level that allows you then to pursue it further. There's something happening here. And you have to trust, you know, that level of self-doubt, and, you know, you have to have a tolerance for uncertainty. The main thing that people don't like to hear is it does require a constant work ethic. I mean, you don't, you know, if you're a writer, you write something every day, and you try these things, and many of them don't get to this other level, but you can't say, well, gee, now we're doing this video, let's just be profound. It just doesn't work that way. You know, you talk around ideas, you interact, and at some days, for whatever reason, things come together more than others. And you may not initially recognize it, you know, what are the little things that cause you to suddenly realize you could do this. I have these images that have figures floating, and that just happened by chance. One day when I was shooting a figure on a black or a white background, I had two shots left at the end, and I was, you know, had posed her in every way I could possibly conceive. And I said, well, jump. So she jumped twice, and I had electronic flash. Years later, you know, at least 3 or 4 years later, that contact sheet of the figure jumping on the white background was lying where it was horizontal next to a waterscape, and I'm suddenly looking, oh my God, if I print it horizontal, she's not jumping, she's floating. And then I figured out how to fake a shadow. But, you know, the idea that you have those kind of seeds that open up possibilities. And after that time, then I went and I photographed this model who was fortunately a former dancer. I shot like 20 rolls of her jumping in various poses and all that, not knowing how I would use it later, but just knowing it gave me the opportunity of floating a figure. When I was lecturing in Boston in 1982, I showed an image that was just in a museum where a wave was breaking in a box, a display that hadn't been put up yet in front of I can show you the print. But in any case, I said at the time, I wish Miner had been alive to see this. I thought he would have liked this image. It was very Zen-like, and he was into this Eastern thought and religion, belief systems. And the next side I showed was this lone boat with just infinite water behind it. After my talk, a man came up to me and said he was at Miner's bedside in the hospital when he died. And his last spoken words were, there's a small boat waiting for me. And then he went into unconsciousness and never, you know, regained it again. And so when I came back to Gainesville, that's when I made this other image with the boat and the sky behind it with this sort of cloud sphere occurring there. And then I read up on the, you know, the death experience. Many people have that have been clinically dead experience a tunnel of light. But the boat, every belief system usually involves a body of water that has to be crossed. I mean, that's an open-ended symbol that people relate to the River Jordan. You know, you have it and so, but for me, it's not attached to any particular belief system. I just see the boat as a metaphor for a spiritual journey. And so from 1982 on, I have many images, like the Voyager image, which I previously mentioned, that involve a boat in some form. So.
Do you ever wake up in the morning and you know, do you think some of these things come from your subconscious or your dreams?
Well, the problem with, I mean, I like the dreamlike sensibility. This is a human, unique phenomenon, I think, that you can invent these realities. But literally, when people tell you their dream, it is just so non-rational. It's like, you know, I was walking down the street, and then I became a fudgesicle, and then I, you know, there's just these breaks that are just so crazy. But I am very much attracted to the idea that, you know, there are ways in which, through that sensibility, you can touch on issues that have some emotional status that for people to respond to. And I try to let myself go into that zone, but it's a very, how can I say, nebulous, open-ended experience to deal with that. But we all, you know, from in the history of art, I mean, the cave paintings are, you know, fantasies of what the possibilities were. So that is a human quality that exists within all of us to invent these other kind of realities. And at some preconscious level, they probably have meaning, and maybe sometimes you figure it out, maybe sometimes you just sense what that reality is, you know, within you.
With the advent of Photoshop, anything is now possible with combining images. When using negatives, there are limits to what you can do, although you have stretched the boundary through many of your printing techniques. Can you discuss the limitations of analog printing and its advantages and disadvantages?
Well, there are really no limitations. I mean, the limitations exist within the attitude of the person working with the material. And anyone, and this would include in the history of the universe, that has contributed in some major way has broken the rules. I mean, they've gone beyond what was the accepted thinking. So that's the attitude that allows. I'm doing things in the darkroom that I've never done before, you know, and so they're not like major breakthroughs, but visually they add a nuance that something that hadn't had occurred in my work before. And one of the things I've said, because I have lectured at some Photoshop conferences, and I always say, well, say something good about Photoshop. It gives you an immense number of visual options. Say something bad about Photoshop. It gives you an immense number of visual options. The point would be it's not so much the number of options you have, but being able to use those options in some effective way to create an image that resonates, first of all, with you. You're the first audience making those decisions, and then hopefully with some other audience. But at the time these images are being created, that's the last thing I'm thinking about. I'm just thinking about my own immediate personal response to what is happening as this image, you know, emerges in the developer.
You taught at the University of Florida at Gainesville. What advice would you give to young and upcoming artists and photographers?
If you're serious about having some kind of career in photography, I do think that you want to have technical skills that would allow you to do all kinds of image making to survive. Fortunately, the university, the academy, the university has been the support system for creative people for many years, for the writers, you know, the philosophy majors, the poets, the art painters. I mean, this has been our support system, and I was grateful to have it because for the first, at least, I don't know, I would say almost 15 years of my career, no one was buying photographs. There weren't even any galleries when I started in the 60s. One in New York, the Limelight Gallery, but you know, it was, I've seen that whole phenomena change where photography has been acceptance. But I do think that you have to, you know, be realistic and have technical skills that would allow you to survive in terms of creating a living somehow. At the same time, you have to have a space or a time where you can be involved with your own, you know, creative research or exploration. And I, you know, mentioned to you, I know many very high-end commercial photographers, and they all have drawers that have their personal work in. You know, they've had to do this work for assignments, but at the same time, they have work that they feel much stronger about in terms of, you know, their whole attitude toward life and photography.
Did the teaching process affect your own work, and if so, in what way?
Well, I happen to love teaching, and there was a cause, because photography was not widely accepted. And so I would spend my weekends making slides. I made slides for every image in the Robert Frank book, you know, the Americans, and then Walker Evans' book, and I would show these side by side and talk about all the implications involved. And in the 60s, when my teaching career was, I started in 1960, more and more students were attracted to photography in terms of exploring ideas. And when you have good students, you know, it makes you a better teacher because they're asking good questions. Education is essentially a question-raising business. And so, you know, teaching involves developing an attitude toward learning more than anything. It's not a little package deal that this is how you process film, okay, check that one off. This is how you make a print, you know, or this goes into the developer for this long. I mean, that's so minimal in terms of the potential growth of anybody as an artist that you have to have those skills, but at the same time, the focus on that is wrong. It's an attitude toward, you know, how you think about things. I mean, I have always felt, and I've said this many times, the illusion of knowledge is one of the great detriments to growth, that once people think they know something, it's the questioning stops. But it's that ongoing ability to question that keeps us as viable human beings. And so to have an attitude that is questioning, to this day, I tell you, I'm in the darkroom questioning constantly, you know, where can this go?
While Photoshop has made it much easier to combine images, a Jerry Uelsmann image is easily recognizable from other artists. What do you contribute to this, and how important is developing a unique style?
It's an interesting question, but I don't think Photoshop has made it easier. I mean, I think that that's one of the myths that are out there, that people that, you know, they first learn it and it gives them options and then they're overwhelmed by it. But, you know, I have had the benefit in the past of, you know, being married to a Photoshop expert, and I'm aware of the levels of subtleties that one can do with Photoshop. At the same time, it's a decision-making process, and while you have, you know, these many different tools, you have to learn how to use those tools, and that's the bottom line. I mean, people tend to think it's easier, but it's the bottom line is coming up with an image that, you know, relates somehow, and that is what the real challenge is. Whether you do it by, you know, a pencil on paper, or do it at in front of a computer, or using Photoshop, or do it in the darkroom, whatever form you use, you know, it's still the end result is coming up with something that, you know, resonates with you as the image maker.
Your work is almost entirely black and white, as photographic color printing has improved and become archival, has been more accepted as fine art. What is your thought on the subject, and why do you love the black and white medium?
At the time I was emerging, the color processes were non-archival and not accepted. And I was also emerging at a time when, you know, the serious films were the Bergman films, the black and white film. And it's, again, if I were younger and working with Photoshop, I'd probably be dealing with color. But, you know, that's another whole segment that when you're creating images that have a dreamlike sensibility, maybe introducing color doesn't always work as well. But I'm not, it's natural for me because I've worked with black and white for years. I could not be doing the process, the things I'm doing in the darkroom now could not be done in color. They could be done on a computer in color. I'm just comfortable with, you know, black and white photography, and I understand the subtleties of it. And it's my medium. That's all I can say. That I'm still crazy about it. It's still magical for me, and I look forward to getting into the darkroom once you guys leave. So there. The question of style. If you can be authentic, the problem is, you do gain insight by studying photography. You know, when I saw the work of Harry Callahan and he'd photograph grass, I'm like, oh my God, I never thought you could photograph grass and make, you know, or even Weston, the pepper. You know, once you see Weston's pepper, there's, you know, you have something that has achieved significance to the vision of the photographer. And you learn by seeing other work that you admire, you know, and by rights of understanding, you're allowed to explore the options that are presented there. But I think it's constant hard work to make an effort to make art in any form that in the long run, you know, you do develop a style, a kind of approach that comes out of you. And today there's many things going on, certainly in the art world, where, you know, the idea dominates, so you have a conceptual basis for it. Or, you know, even in the museums where they have a theme that they want to deal with social issues, so that dominates what, you know, imagery is selected. But as an individual, I don't know how important it is, style, but I just think style is a byproduct of someone working authentically for a long period of time. I think that there's a spiritual quality in my work that goes back many, many years. And it's, you know, I was very impressed when I read Joseph Campbell's book, certainly studying with Minor White. He had us read Zen and the Art of Archery. And I mean, there were books that just developed with that kind of attitude. And I do think, I'm not talking about specific belief systems here, but many people find ways of connecting with my work on a spiritual basis, that there's a kind of charisma or something that happens there. And it's not one that you can consciously do it, but I do think, you know, the darkroom has become both a meditative space for me to be in, and, it allows that phenomena to occur.
So how old is this player piano?
Well, what people don't realize, they're not that rare. Back before radio, everybody that could afford a player piano had one. So they were in turn of the century, really. But they were made in vast quantities. But now, of course, they're not electrified.
Central Monday morning rail. There are 15 cars and 15 restless riders, 3 conductors and 25 sacks of mail. They're all out on the southbound Odyssey, and the train pulls out of Kankakee, rolls past the houses, farms and fields, passing towns that have no name, and freight yards full of old black men, and the graveyards of rusted automobiles. Singing good morning America, how are you? Saying don't you know me, I'm your native son. Yes, I'm the train they call the city of New Orleans, and I'll be gone 500 miles away.